Epithelial tissues are classified according to the shape of the cells and number of the cell layers formed. The cell shapes can be squamous, cuboidal, or columnar. Squamous cells are flattened and thin. Cuboidal cells are boxy, as wide as they are tall. Columnar cells are rectangular, taller than they are wide. The number of cell layers in each tissue can vary from one to many. Epithelium can be categorized as a simple epithelium when the number of cell layers in the tissue is only one, in other words, where every cell rests on the basal lamina. When there is more than one layer of this tissue, we can refer to it as stratified epithelium. In stratified epithelium, only the basal layer of cells rests on the basal lamina. There's also pseudostratified tissue, which describes tissue with a single layer that deceivingly give the appearance of more than one layer. Transitional epithelium describes forms of specialized stratified epithelium in which the shape of the cells vary. Simple epithelium. The cells in simple squamous epithelium have the appearance of thin scales. Squamous cell nuclei tend to be flat, horizontal, and elliptical, mirroring the form of the cell. The endothelium is the epithelial tissue that lines the vessels of the lymphatic and cardiovascular systems, and it is made up of a single layer of squamous cells. Simple squamous epithelium is present where rapid passage of chemical compounds is observed. For example, the alveoli of the lungs, where gases diffuse, segments of kidney tubules, and the lining of capillaries are all made up of simple squamous epithelial tissue. The mesothelium is a simple squamous epithelium that forms the surface layer of the serous membranes that line the body cavities and internal organs. Mesothelial cells are squamous epithelial cells that secrete fluid that lubricates the mesothelium. In simple cuboidal epithelium, the nucleus of the box-like cells appears round and is generally centrally located. These epithelia are active in the secretion and absorption of molecules. Simple cuboidal epithelia are observed in the lining of the kidney tubules and in the ducts of glands. In simple columnar epithelium, the nucleus of the tall column-like cells tends to be elongated and located at the basal end of the cells. Like cuboidal epithelium, this epithelium is active in the absorption and secretion of molecules. Simple columnar epithelium forms the lining of some sections of the digestive system and parts of the female reproductive tract. Ciliated columnar epithelium is composed of simple columnar epithelial cells with cilia on the apical surface. These epithelial cells are found in the lining of the fallopian tubes and parts of the respiratory system, where beating of the cilia helps to remove particulate matter. Pseudostratified columnar epithelium. Pseudostratified columnar epithelium is a type of epithelium that appears to be stratified, but it consists of only a single layer. In pseudostratified epithelium, nuclei of neighboring cells appear at different levels rather than clustered at the basal end. The arrangement gives the appearance of stratification, but in fact, all the cells are in contact with the basal lamina. Pseudostratified columnar epithelium is found in the respiratory tract, where some of the cells have cilia. Both simple and pseudostratified columnar epithelia are heterogeneous epithelia because they include additional types of cells interspersed among epithelial cells. For example, a goblet cell is a mucus-secreting unicellular gland interspersed between the columnar epithelial cells of mucous membranes. Stratified epithelium. A stratified epithelium consists of several stacked layers of cells. This epithelium protects against physical and chemical wear and tear. The stratified epithelium is named by the shape of the most apical layer of cells. Stratified squamous epithelium is the most common type of stratified epithelium in the human body. The apical cells are squamous, whereas the basal layers either contain columnar or cuboidal cells. The top layer may be covered with dead cells filled with keratin. Mammalian skin is an example of this dry, keratinized, stratified squamous epithelium. The lining of the mouth cavity is an example of unkeratinized stratified squamous epithelium. Stratified cuboidal epithelium and stratified columnar epithelium can also be found in certain glands and ducts, but are not common in the human body. Another kind of stratified epithelium is transitional epithelium, so called because of the gradual changes in the shape of apical cells as the bladder fills with urine. It is found only in the urinary system, specifically the ureters and the urinary bladder. When the bladder is empty, this epithelium is convoluted and has cuboidal apical cells with convex umbrella-shaped apical surfaces. As the bladder fills with urine, the epithelium loses its convolutions and the apical cells transition from cuboidal to squamous. Glandular epithelium. A gland is a structure made up of one or more cells modified to synthesize and secrete chemical substances. Most glands consist of groups of epithelial cells. A gland can be classified as an endocrine gland or an exocrine gland. Endocrine glands are ductless glands that release secretions directly into the surrounding tissues and fluids. Exocrine glands has secretions that leave through a duct. The duct opens either directly or indirectly to the external environment. Endocrine glands. The secretions of endocrine glands are called hormones. Hormones are released into the interstitial fluid, diffused into the bloodstream, and delivered to targets. In other words, cells that have receptors to bind to the hormones can be thought of as the targets. The endocrine system is part of a major regulatory system coordinating the regulation and integration of the body responses. A few examples of endocrine glands include the anterior pituitary, the thymus, the adrenal cortex, and the gonads. Exocrine glands. Exocrine glands release their contents through a duct that leads to the epithelial surface. Mucus, sweat, saliva, and breast milk are all examples of secretions coming from exocrine glands. These secretions are all discharged through tubular ducts. Secretions into the lumen of the gastrointestinal tract technically occur outside of the body and are considered exocrine. Glandular structure. Exocrine glands are classified as either unicellular or multicellular. The unicellular glands are scattered single cells, such as goblet cells, found in the mucosa membranes of the small and large intestine. The multicellular exocrine glands, known as serous glands, develop from simple epithelium to form a secretory surface that secretes directly into an inner cavity. These glands line the internal cavities of the abdomen and chest and release their secretions directly into the cavities. Other multicellular exocrine glands release their contents through a tubular duct. The duct is single in a simple gland, but in a compound gland is divided into one or more branches. In tubular glands, the ducts can be straight or coiled, whereas tubes that form pockets are alveolar, such as the exocrine portion of the pancreas. Combinations of tubes and pockets are known as tubulo-alveolar compound glands. In a branched gland, a duct is connected to more than one secretory group of cells. Methods and types of secretion. Exocrine glands can be classified by their mode of secretion and the nature of substances released, as well as by the structure of the glands and shape of the ducts. Merocrine secretion is the most common type of exocrine secretion. The secretions are enclosed in vesicles that move to the apical surface of the cell, where then the contents are released by exocytosis. For example, watery mucus containing the glycoprotein mucin is a merocrine secretion. The eccrine glands that produce and secrete sweat are another example. Apocrine secretion accumulates near the apical portion of the cell. That portion of the cell and its secretory contents pinch off from the cell and are released. Apocrine sweat glands in the axillary and genital areas release fatty secretions that local bacteria break down. This process causes body odor. Both merocrine and apocrine glands continue to produce and secrete their contents with little damage caused to the cell because the nucleus and Golgi regions remain intact after secretion. In contrast, the production of halocrine secretion involves the rupture and destruction of the entire gland cell. The cell accumulates its secretory products and releases them only in bursts. New gland cells differentiate from the cells in the surrounding tissue to replace those lost by the secretion. The sebaceous glands that produce the oils on the skin and hair are halocrine glands. Glands are also named after the products they produce. The serous gland produces watery blood plasma-like secretions rich in enzymes such as alpha amylase, whereas the mucus gland releases watery to viscous products rich in glycoprotein mucin. Both serous and mucus glands are common in the salivary glands of the mouth. Mixed exocrine glands contain both serous and mucus glands and release both types of secretions.